How long will this battle continue to go on to protect the rights of the homeless? Only God knows. Are we ready to go for 18 years like they did in Atlanta, Georgia? We're going to take a look at that particular community and the ongoing battle they're having there. We must be ready to go on as long as we have to, so everyone has a place to sleep every night. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. How long? Not long. We're going to continue to trust God. We've got to trust God. We have to believe God. There's too many lives at stake, too many people that are homeless. We can't give up now. I have with me Kalor, and he's joining me. Kalor, you know in your own life how critical it is that we keep 1411 Locust open for the homeless, don't we?
Oh, yes, I do. Very important.
Now, you just joined Chris. You guys went to Atlanta, Georgia, and there you got to know some folks that have been involved in an 18-year battle to continue to keep the place open, haven't you?
Yes, I have.
What did it mean to you to make that trip?
It was pretty good, because I learned a lot there, because a lot of people have been going through a lot of things that's been going through here, and it's just seems like the battle there is a lot harder than it is here, though. I mean, they've been going through it for so long.
They've been at it 18 years. We don't know how hard it's going to get. We got to just be ready to go for as long as it's got to go, right?
Just got to pray.
We got to continue to keep the place open, don't we?
Hell yeah.
Let's go to Chris as he talks to Dr. Jim Beatty.
Hello, I'm Chris Rice, and I'm here with someone who is really important for the Metro Atlanta Task Force for the Homeless, Dr. Jim Beatty. Dr. Jim, tell us about yourself. What's your background as an educator, as a minister?
Well, as a minister, I was ordained as a Presbyterian minister many, many years ago. I graduated from Columbia Seminary here in Atlanta, Georgia. And I became an ordained Presbyterian minister and served a church. And after that, I went back to graduate school in English literature. I got into teaching in high school substitute in Ashland-LaGrange, Georgia, and loved it. I had never so much as taught a Sunday school class, but I loved it, and had a little church there in LaGrange. And then I moved back to Columbia, South Carolina to do my doctoral work in English. And Atlanta Presbytery would not let me remain ordained because I was not laboring outside the bounds of Presbytery or some other ecclesiastical jargon like that. So I was not divested. I wasn't defrocked, I was divested. I don't know those ecclesiastical terms and care less of what they are. But anyway, I am an ordained minister of the gospel, and through our adopting a homeless baby, we became involved 30 years ago with homeless people.
So Anita Beatty is your wife.
Anita Beatty is my wife.
And what involvement have you had with the Metro Atlanta Task Force here?
Well, until about 5 years ago, we were co-directors, and the board had need to make me chairman of the board. So I have, for the last 4 or 5 years, I've been chairman of the board. But Anita is the energy and the spirit and the brains behind the task force, and I simply tag along.
Okay.
But I'm here. Actually, I do chaplain work and counseling work, and I work primarily with the men in transition now.
Okay.
But I've been on board for a long, long time and loving every minute of it.
What does that look like as a chaplain here? Do you have regular meetings with them? Do you preach here?
I meet regularly 2 times a week with the men in transition. Mm-hmm. Those are the only formal meetings that I have. We have so many churches that come in and preach.
Okay.
And sometimes...
How often does that happen?
Well, we have 42 churches, and some 30 of them come in and preach. And the men are preached to 2-3 times every day.
Wow.
And we have people We have one man that we had a banquet giving out awards, and he had been saved more than anybody ever in the history of the church. And it's too much is too much sometimes.
Yeah, yeah.
But don't misunderstand.
So they come in and serve meals too?
They come in. Some of them serve meals. Mm-hmm. Some churches come in and serve meals and don't preach.
Okay.
They understand the need that has already been met.
Yeah.
Others come and preach only.
Okay.
But overall, it's a good thing, and we appreciate that. But that's why I don't preach here, only in counseling and in individual work.
You were doing the camera work back there, weren't you, when Chris was talking to him?
Yes, I was.
And you had a chance to be a part of all this. Did you get to know a lot of the homeless people there in that shelter?
Yes, I did. I met quite a few people. They're really nice people.
What did they think about you doing the camera work and the training you were getting?
They was really curious about how I was learning it all.
Did you stay in the shelter there with them?
We stayed at a place called Open Door Community.
Uh-huh. You got to know some of them at that shelter too.
Yeah.
So what did it mean to you here, man, previously homeless? You're getting broadcast training. You travel across the United States with Chris, interact in this way.
I think it's a blessing. I mean, when I first came to New Life, I never thought I'd be doing anything like this. So, I mean, it's been a blessing. I mean, as long as I keep my head on straight and continue to believe in the Lord, anything's possible.
Were you encouraged as you heard how they were having to stand steadfast, particularly in light of the battle we're facing right now?
Yes, I am. I mean, it makes me want to fight harder. You know, cause I don't want to see New Life shut down. I mean, we help so many people here.
Well, let's go back to Chris as they discuss the battle they've been encountering in Atlanta, Georgia.
So you're really passionate about what's been taking place here as far as the city's involvement, not just the city, but a lot of other parties too, in attempting to shut down this work, essentially shut down your ministry.
Absolutely.
And so you're very vocal about it on your blog. Tell us about how you started doing that and where people can find it.
Right. Well, my blog address is, I think it's Dr. Jim Beatty at WordPress.com, something like that. And I apologize for that doctor, but somebody put it on there. But it's WordPress.com. I've written 475 blogs, and I started writing the blog purely as my own therapy.
Mm-hmm.
The heel of the city's boot has been on our throat for 25 years.
Wow.
They despise poor black people. Mm-hmm. They despise anybody who tries to help them if they're not under their guise and under their guidance, which is no guise and no guidance, actually. So I began writing for therapy. Then we got into the lawsuits, and they have been just so overwhelmingly wonderful. The attorneys that have taken us on and worked for us, no one in Atlanta ever believed that anybody would sue the principalities and powers downtown.
Mm.
But they did, and consequently, we're still in the building after 4 years after they stole it. I write in my blog about Naboth's Vineyard,
mm-hmm.
and this is Naboth's Vineyard, and the principalities and powers came in to take it. And unlike Jezebel and Ahaz, they have not taken it yet.
Yeah.
That does not mean they won't. I think until the Lord comes and deals with them one way or another, that they have the power to take it, and they very well will do that, but not so far.
So you don't have any problem on your blog naming names of people that are behind all this?
Oh, absolutely not. I not only name names, I give them nicknames. I give them middle names as to what they've done. But I was deposed 5 hours by the city. In the lawsuit, we sued the city, and the federal judges, of course, threw it out. There, I think it's called sovereign immunity.
Oh, wow.
I say in my blog, it's the same thing Henry VIII had. You know, he killed two or three wives, and you can't sue the king. Well, you can't sue the city for their wrongdoing. No, I was deposed for 5 hours. And they did not ask me a single question after my name and credentials that was not based on my blog. And for 5 hours, they could not catch me in anything that was not true. Wow. Not one single thing. I research pretty well any facts that I put down. Now my middle names for the scoundrels downtown, that may not be all that, you know, accurate. I may underdo it.
Embellish some of that.
Well, I actually, where I'm inaccurate was on the low side.
Okay.
In fact, I had to apologize to the retiring United Way head. I published that he was given $1 million bonus.
Yeah.
And I found in a newspaper article right after I published it that it was $1.5 million.
Oh.
So I had to apologize, saying that his bonus was not nearly as, I didn't say that it was nearly as high as it was.
How does this work affect a man? Well, we're going to hear further on that, but you were indicating how the work affects you. You feel like you're growing in your faith, Kalor?
Yes, I am. I grow every day in my faith.
You know, when you have a battle like what we're encountering at the New Life Evangelistic Center, I can understand, identify with this man of God, and what him and his wife are going through. But their faith is important to them, isn't it?
Yes, faith is very important. I mean, without your faith, I mean, you can lose it all. I mean, just like one day you can have it all, and the next day you can lose it all.
And that's how we keep going day by day. I just thank God every day is a miracle, a new miracle, as we have to trust Him for that financial resource to continue the battle we're encountering here at the New Life Evangelistic Center. Let's go back to Chris.
So how does this affect you in social circles around the city? Do people, I don't know, do you feel the heat or the pressure as though, you know, there's a lot of people that don't appreciate what you're doing?
If you are asking me, if it does any good with those people, absolutely not. But it wouldn't have done any good if we were silent.
Yeah.
It's just like Lasorda talking about baseball teams. Mm-hmm. He used to tell the Dodgers, you're going to lose a third of the games. You're going to win a third of the games. But that middle group, we can beat and go to the World Series. We have a middle group that we have reached with my blog.
Yeah.
In fact, some of the strongest spiritual and financial religious leaders that we have come here having bumped up on my blog. Now, not many.
Yeah.
I don't have all that widespread reading. But exposing the scoundrels, as Jeremiah did in the fifth chapter of Jeremiah, exposing the scoundrels sometimes brings in the righteous who want to help.
How I thank God for those of you who do pray for us here at New Life Evangelistic Center. We want to share with you and let you hear from these individuals that are on the front lines. They've been involved in this battle for 18 years, Kalor. That's a long time, isn't it?
18 years, that's a long time to be fighting.
Well, I see that it kind of goes with the fact that we've got to do what God has called us to do. And yes, we're soldiers in the army of the Lord.
Yes,
onward, Christian soldiers. We can't give up now. There's too many lives dependent on us.
Not too many lives. I mean, there's people out dying in the street every day from being cold, you know, sleep deprivation. I mean, it's a number of things that people suffer from. And if we don't have places like New Life or the Atlanta Task Force that help people out like that, there'd be many more that's dying in the street.
And that's why we share with you their thoughts on the battle, and you hear from us quite a bit. I want to go back to Chris and Dr. Jim Beatty.
So I could just say in St. Louis, there's a lot of the attitude as far as working together with the city among those people within the continuum of care and others are, they feel like they can, you know, change the heart of the city toward helping the poor if they just, you know, kind of have backroom deals that don't go public and things like that. But they feel like, you know, you can, you know, catch more flies with honey, that type of mentality. Here it seems like the gloves have come off. And for us in St. Louis as well, the gloves have come off. It's become very clear that you know, there's no backing down on their part from shutting us down. What's your thinking on that?
My thinking on that, if I can borrow from St. Paul, He speaks of the principalities and powers in Colossians that Jesus nailed to his cross. It made him an open scandal. The principalities and powers that Paul talked about are not going to be won. You might have one or two here or there. And I'm not saying they're not good, righteous people in city government in Atlanta. There certainly are. In fact, we have deep throats who are on our side and help us and cheered when we were able to pay $600,000 back water bill, because that was one of their last bastions to close us down. They knew that they could bring the county in and say, well, you can't flush your toilets. You don't have water to shower. They could have done that. And they wouldn't receive $100,000. They would not take it, wouldn't let us pay it.
Yeah.
But then when we went to $600,000 by law, they had to receive it. I think that Isaiah, whichever Isaiah the theologians let us talk about now, I think that he had a working relationship with the government. And I don't know the book of Isaiah the way I do Jeremiah. But there is a place for God's people, righteous people, to work with city governments. I am not one of those who've been called to do that.
Okay.
When you've had the heel of their boot on your throat for as long as you had a throat, there's just not much reason for me to go down and try to be buddy-buddy with the mayor.
Well, that's kind of how it is for us now. How could we work together with a city that has made it very clear they want to reduce our population from 300 people to 32 people? And then they come along, you know, head of human service, Eddie Roth, comes along and says, now, won't you work together with us in doing that?
Yeah.
You know, what... And why would we work together with you and in essentially telling our congregation, sorry, you've got to go?
Right. And if they ever tell you they want to work with you, and that's not a blatant falsehood, then they're doing it for some reason that they're going to benefit themselves.
Exactly.
It's like when we got $12 million years ago to give to homeless shelters all over Atlanta. Mayor Bill Campbell, before he went to jail, he holds up the check. Saying the city of Atlanta, look what the city got. Well, Anita Beatty and the Atlanta Task Force for the Homeless got it.
Yeah.
In fact, the city would not apply for it. They came to us and said, we can't do it. You all do it. We did it. That's just an example.
So, in other words, they want the agencies to do the work, and they claim the credit.
Well, certainly they claim the credit if there's any work done, but they don't want any work done for homeless people.
Okay.
Any notion, any hint that they want to help homeless people. I mean, this criminal Bloomberg in New York, he gives Atlanta millions of dollars for homeless people. Nothing's been done for homeless people with that money. And you think they'd give us a dollar to help these 65 women and their babies that are two rooms over from us that have nowhere else to go? Because the city's gateway model shelter that I write about so much in my blog, $50 million, they won't take women and children. But they send us over here and then have creative loafing or some other rag sheet that's out there come and interview and say, what do you say when people say you poorly manage and you don't manage? I told poor Anita to tell him, you can't build bricks without straw. The Egyptian pharaoh has ordered us to build bricks, and he says, oh, by the way, you don't have any more straw. You don't get straw. They've cut all our funds. That's our straw.
Yeah.
Won't give us a dollar. And they say, you got women over there on the floor. You scoundrels. You're not doing right by our women. That's their procedure.
So they want to blame you for having the women in here on the floor instead of in a bed, and they won't do anything themselves
to shelter them. And they've sent us here either literally or de facto because their shelters are closed to them.
Yeah. Well, it sounds very much like St. Louis, sounds very much like what we're going through. I just appreciate you taking the time to tell us your story and about your blog.
Are you kidding me? We're so glad to have you here.
Thank you.
Thank you for doing this.
Because of Caring Volunteers, they're doing a lot of things in that shelter. And again, we could use volunteers to help us do even more here at 1411 Locust and our other facilities. If you'd like to volunteer, call us at 314-881-3218. Kalar, you went on the roof. You saw what they're doing there, right?
Oh, yeah.
You saw how they got individuals to help build their bunks.
Yeah, it was pretty interesting. I saw Carl had showed us these bunks that are... at a school comes in and volunteer, they take the top of it off and they make like a little shelf out of the top part of the bunk and they sleep on the bottom part of the bunk.
Wow, we'd like to have some of that done, whether it's at our new Illinois shelter or here at 1411 Locust. Let's go to Carl.
These bunks were designed by students and professors at Georgia Tech, and they had a design competition, and they took one of the old metal bunks, double bunks, cut it down, put the plastic on there to give them some privacy and a little extra wood treatment, give it a softer feel, and then took the top bunk and turned it on its side and made a storage bin out of it.
Wow, that's pretty cool.
And so every man has his bunk, individual bunk, and then also a storage facility and some little bit of privacy.
And they made them like this for you?
We had
the students build them here
on site.
Mm-hmm.
That's great.
We're doing a lot of exciting things in Atlanta, and we're picking up additional ideas. And wow, we could even have a garden on the roof. You went up and saw their garden on the roof. What did you think of that?
Yeah, I thought that was beautiful. I mean, it's like one section of the whole roof had nothing but beds go there, and it grows all year round, you know, with the weather being so nice there.
So you were inspired by that?
Oh yeah.
Well, these are some additional things that we could perhaps do. If you'd volunteer here at the New Life Evangelistic Center, you got ideas, ways we can help more people, we'd love to hear them. If you're willing to help us carry them out, we need your help. We need you to get involved. And again, the number is 314-881-3218. Let's go to Carl. He'll show us that rooftop garden.
And this is our roof garden at Peachtree and Pine. And we started it about 5 years ago. And it's grown from just originally 2 beds to then 10 beds, then 20 and 40. And now this year we've had 80 beds. And so we have enough bed space now to plant vegetables that will be used in our cafeteria downstairs on a weekly basis to supplement the meals that the men receive from the churches that come in to feed in the evening. And we grow spinach, kale, collard greens, okra, cabbage, strawberries. We grew some watermelons last year. So we have a really full range of vegetables and fruits. And the men that work the garden during the summer, spring and summer, actually have been trained in urban farming at a nonprofit over here in the King, Martin Luther King District, that has the Rashid Nouri's group called Truly Living Well, and they have a course for training men to work in the garden. And they come up here, they come and work in the garden, and they prepared the beds for planting for this spring. And so we're now in the process of planting our spring garden that we'll start harvesting in March.
So right now, what are you growing?
Right now we have planted, you can see we've got a bed of collards we've planted. And then we planted a bed of Swiss chard. And then I think this might be lettuce in this bed. And then radishes in this bed. And we're planting one row of beds a week. And that'll be 8 weeks of planting. And by the 8th week, the first bed will be matured and we can begin to harvest the first bed. And so we'll have a weekly harvest of vegetables all through the spring. And then we'll start again after that's been finished harvest, start planting a summer crop, which will primarily be squash and beans. So we'll have something in production here from maybe March through October. And if you notice, the beds actually are painted, and some of them have scriptures on them, and they were donated and built by the churches that have helped us build and maintain this garden. and you'll notice the mural around the wall, exterior wall, ring wall, was painted by the same gentleman that did the stairwell, and he painted the black outlines and gave us the color scheme, and then the churches, the children from the churches came and painted the colors within the black lines. So we've had a lot of fun up here with a lot of people.
So who's involved in working in the garden?
We have about, right now we have, over the past, we've had about 10 or 12 of the men that have come and gotten trained and have worked here in the garden. And then when we need maybe dirt hauled up or have a big harvest, either the churches come help us or church group kids come during the summer and the winter breaks. And then also we have the men in the drop-in center downstairs. We'll get them to come up here and help us either haul dirt up or rebuild the beds or something like that. So it's an activity center for all our volunteers and our men that stay with us.
Oh, wow. So people in the RV program as well as people just coming in off the street?
People that come in off the street can come up here and work with us so they get exposed to the gardening if they want to further that their knowledge and become part of the garden club. We meet weekly. And then we also have as I mentioned, Rashid Nuri's group, Truly Living Well, that actually conducts courses and trains the men that are willing to go through the six-month program to get trained as urban farmers.
This is truly exciting to just see what this other group is doing. Chris is joining me at this time. Chris, we heard you earlier doing interviews. We've seen the rooftop garden. We could do a lot of volunteers that catch the vision and kind of help us in this area. What couldn't we?
Absolutely. Another thing that they have there was the front of the building. Mm-hmm. It looks really, really nice. And inside, they actually have like an art studio. And they have a curator who's just a volunteer. And she comes in certain days of the week, and she actually makes these beautiful oil paintings of people that are in their RV program, transitional housing program, or homeless people in there. They also have a local university will do photography classes around the shelter, and then they'll show the prints there in the studio. Just lots of really neat ideas. They have a vision for how they want to use more space in the building. And they're doing this all the while. For the last 5 years, they've been fighting foreclosure. And so their legal team has worked pro bono. Mm-hmm. And many people can just really see how the city has, in a very heavy-handed way, just marked them for destruction. And so they've just got volunteers that have come out and are really giving of themselves, finding it rewarding. They've got local universities. Ministerial students are coming in and giving hours and hours of their time as case managers. And it's a beautiful outpouring of love. And I'd really love to see, you know, that take place within NLEC as well.
If you can volunteer, you've got ideas, let's pray about them. If you're willing to help do them, 314-881-3218. That's 314-881-3218. It's been a long battle, 18 years. Chris, we just don't want to keep fighting. We want to do mm-hmm. the work of Jesus. But if that's necessary to do the work of Jesus, he told us to be in the world but not of the world and be willing to fight the good fight. We got to obey God rather than men.
That's right. That's right. Part of their legal battle has actually been using the Fair Housing Act in federal mm-hmm. court. But, you know, the city claimed sovereign immunity. That's what happened is that, you know, the municipality can do that when they come in with the Fair Housing Act. So the judge would just throw it out every time they did it. I believe we've got a better case using our LUPA, just the fact that we're a church, you know, that's different. But, we don't want to fight for forever. But what happens is when the community really comes together in this way, it gives more people the opportunity to be a blessing. And so good can come out of, you know, even something as awful as being fought by, you know, the city.
And so we must continue in the battle that God has laid before us here in the greater St. Louis area. It's so important, not only for the right for an individual to have a place to sleep, but for the right for a church, like New Life Evangelistic Center, which is a church, to not just be a hearer of the word and talker of the word, but a doer of the word. And when local government says you can't do what Jesus has told you to do, we got to do what the early disciples say, and that is to obey God rather than man. And you make that possible as you continue to pray for New Life Evangelistic Center and share your much-needed gift. May God bless you for caring and sharing at this critical hour.